गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुसाक्षात् परम ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्रुतिस्मृति पुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तं। ओ माय गॉड, सूत्र भाष्य कृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः नमामि गौड़पादं च शंकरं श्रीसुरेश्वरं स्वामिनं सच्चिदानन्दमिन्द्रं तं ज्ञानरूपिणे। आई थिंक इफ करोना कंटिन्यूस लॉकडाउन वी वोंट बी एबल टू डू एनीथिंग। वंदु करंट होयितु, आल बल्बुगळु साकेट्गळु बल्बुगळु एल्ल फ्यूज आगिबिट्टिवे। इलेक्ट्रिशियन बरबेकु, इलेक्ट्रिशियन बरुवुदु कष्ट। Even if electrician comes, and then the electric things won't be available, so this one bulb is running, and charging also little bit I am able to do. All sockets are fused, so because of the fluctuation. So if it comes, okay. Otherwise, we don't know how long we will be able to continue. So when lockdown over, then electrician does something, then we will be able to speak. Anyway. We'll run as long as we can do with this limited. Okay, Om. With this semi darkness we have to continue. Okay, so athatho brahma jignyasa, the knowledge, he says, just by knowing. We were discussing knowledge alone gives you, knowledge alone helps you to attain brahman or attain moksha. Attain moksha. So knowledge alone, by knowing Brahman alone you attain moksha. From this, what is the implication? By knowing one thing, see here says, anyat anyajnanat anyapraptihi nahi upapadyate. Nahi anyajnanat anyapraptihi upapadyate. A sentence little later, after two sentences I am talking. So because these are all interconnected, these 3-4 sentences. So if you, two things he is telling. One is the very knowing helps you to attain Brahman or moksha, whatever you say, Brahman or moksha. The very knowing helps you to attain Brahma or moksha. Or in other words, very knowing is attainment of Brahma. So after knowing, there is no some other process, some other effort in order to reach moksha or in order to reach Brahman. So the very knowing is attaining Brahman. If this is the case, now the next implication arises. That means what can be attained just by knowing can't be something away from you, because that means it is already in your experience. What is already in your experience but not paid attention to, not recognized, only such can be attained just by knowing. Here the two things. One is knowledge alone takes you to moksha. Second thing is that knowledge helps you to attain what is already in your anubhava. These are the two points. Because these are the two points in contrast with many other schools. Many other schools, those who have interpreted Vedanta, they told knowing itself, the very idea which I discussed yesterday, just briefly I tell and proceed. The knowing which they talk of, the jnanam which they talk of, is not direct jnanam of Brahman. The knowledge which they talk of is not direct jnanam, is not anubhava jnanam of Brahman. The knowledge they talk of is only a remote knowledge, a theoretical knowledge, a just an informative knowledge. So you use the knowledge for meditating for some action, and as a result of meditation you get Brahman. So here knowledge is only a facilitating your meditation. Then when you don't know, when you don't know what is Brahman, no means when you don't experience Brahman directly, what do you meditate upon? So without knowing Brahman, when you, and that too Brahman is something away from you. Why very knowing is not attainment of Brahman? Once let us see. Just by knowing is the attainment of Brahman? No. Because attainment of Brahman is due to some other effort. Because for them I am talking, for them Brahman is something away from them. Therefore, knowing doesn't give you direct experience. See, knowing doesn't give you direct experience for them because Brahman is away from the jiva, away from your Atma. If Brahman is away from Atma, then knowing, what do you know? How do you know? Whatever the Shastra says, you come to listen, you form an opinion, you form a concept. You form a concept of Brahman, that concept is not the experience of Brahman. Okay. Therefore, the knowing doesn't give you Brahman because Brahman is away from you. Okay, how do you attain that Brahman? Because knowing doesn't help you. Therefore, they interpreted, wherever the word jnanam comes in the Upanishads, they took all the words, all the places in the Upanishads, wherever the word jnanam comes, they took it only as an upasana. Upasana is a mental process. Is a mental effort, mental karma, manasika karma. It is a manasa karma. Mind has to dwell upon it. By repeated dwelling, mind transforms into something. So the transformation is a result of a mental functioning, manasika karma, by dwelling upon it. So it is a result, so where the mind has to be transformed, two things. And also you acquire a punya. Because of the punya, after the death of the body, your mind assumes a divine deha suited to your Brahmaloka. And also you will be transported to Brahmaloka on account of punya. Two things. Punya helps you to transport you to that loka. And your meditation, continuous manasika karma, transforms your mind. Transforms your mind, purifies your mind, transforms your mind to be able to assume a body suited to Brahmaloka. Brahmaloka yogya shariram you will assume. So these two are karma phalam only. Means they are the effect of karma. You have to do long process, you have to transform and you have to reach. Reaching is the loka, transforming is your mind. So, both are karma phalam. So, therefore, attaining moksha for them is only a result of karma. Then what is jnanam? Jnanam is only a simple information knowledge as how to operate. It is something like, you know, a machine. How to operate the machine? They'll tell you, switch on here, switch off here, and you touch here, you move this thing, you turn left, you turn right, and then it starts moving. Then you go there, put oil here. This they give you information. But that information doesn't make you to run. After information, you have to running is a separate attempt, is another effort. And machine runs not by knowing, machine runs by doing something. Similarly, for them, knowledge doesn't give you moksha directly. After the knowledge, some process has to take place, some process has to intervene. This is the difference. But for Advaitins, Upanishads talks of two types of jnanam. One is upasana type of jnanam. Another is direct jnanam, intuitive jnanam, anubhava jnanam. As you know, you are that. So because there are two portions. One is a directly experiencing Brahma. Another is reaching a Brahma in a loka. Brahma means Paramatma. One is intuiting the Brahman right now. One knowledge helps you to, that is Advaitin's knowledge helps you to intuit Brahman right now. Right now in the sense, you don't have to go elsewhere. But the another one is, you have to be transported to another loka and there you will witness Brahman. You will witness, you don't become Brahma, you will witness only. You will be in his company. You will be in the company of Brahma, or at least you will be in the coexisting with Brahma. you will be Vaikuntha, you will be coexisting with Brahma. Coexisting means you will be living in the, what you call, co-inhabiting the loka. You will be inhabiting the same loka, or you will be living intimate to him, around him, or you will be a part of him. Salokya, Sarupya, Samipya. Salokya, living in the same world. You will be inhabiting the same loka. Samipya, you will be nearby around him only, very much close around him. Or another thing is, you will become a part of him, intimately part of him. So, Sarokya, Samipya, Sayujya. Okay. Or Sarashti, you will have all powers similar to Vishnu. You will have a power, all siddhis very much similar to Vishnu. Appearance, the beauty and the power and the heart and everything. This is a Sadrushya Mukti. Sarashti means you will become very much similar. Very much similar to Vishnu's form. Very much similar means you, Vishnu, only Vishnu will give you all things similar to him, except one thing. Srishti Stiti Laya. Creating the world, protecting the world and dissolving the world. Only this power he retains. In all other qualities, Vishnu will share with you. Vishnu will share with you. If Vishnu means Brahma, whoever is the Brahma, Shiva or Devi, whatever you are. So, if Paramatma or Brahma wants to do Anugraha, you also can do equally Anugraha. So, you will be similar to Paramatma in all his powers and capacity. You will bless the people, you will do Anugraha, you will have all powers of Vishnu, all capacities of your Paramatma. Except only Srishti Stiti Laya power alone he will retain it. Except that any other things you can do. Any other things he shares with you, he allows you. It is something like you become a deputy prime minister. So he can do all things which prime minister does it. Except one, probably one thing, one or two important things he retains. Remaining all he shares with you. So this is one. So within the Vaikuntha or within that Brahmaloka, also there are variations of Brahmaloka Anubhava. Variations of Brahmaloka Anubhava. One is Salokya, living in the same world. Coexisting in the same world. Samipya, giving so close by, very surrounding him, just surrounding, around him, very close to him. Third is you become a part of him, or you become a limb of him like Shankha Chakra, etc. Shankha Chakra or whatever Trishulam he has got, you become that. Or if you are a Shiva Bhakta, you will become a snake and will be around his neck. Okay. Or Devi's Ayudha, Devi's Ayudhas you will become. Or you will have a Trishula. You will become Trishula in the hands of Shiva, or Damaru in the hands of Shiva, if you like music. Or you will become a snake around his neck. Naga Bharana. You will become the Naga around his, what you call, neck. Or Jata. You will become a Jata of him. Or you will become a Ganga and sitting on his head. Like this. These are all becoming a part of him. Fourth is, you will have all powers similar to him. Salokya, Samipya, Sarupya. Sarupya is similarity. Sarupya is similarity in form. Sarshti, there is a fifth moksha. That is a Brahmaloka moksha, is a fifth moksha. Sarshti is, you will have all powers equal to him. Sarupya is in appearance, you will be similar to Vishnu. A Vishnu or Shiva, or Devi. You will become Devi. Like Vashinyadi Devatas are very much similar, they live with her. In Devi Bhaktas. Vashinyadi Devatas are just, they also have got so much of powers. They live so close to her. They look like Devi. Almost they have many powers, many capacities similar to her. So they are all Bhaktas. They have done lot of upasanas. For thousands of years, for 10 janmas, they have done meditations on Devi. So as a result of that, they go there. Okay. So like this, Salokya, Sarupya. Sarupya means very much similar. Samipya, very close to him. Salokya, Sarupya, Samipya, Sarshti, Sayujya. Sayujya means you become a part of him. This is a little deviation. Some people are thinking that Sayujya is Advaita Moksha. No. Sayujya is not Advaita. Sayujya is becoming a part of him like a Shankha Chakra. Just now I told you Trishula and etc. Sayujya is becoming a part of Brahma Devata. Or that Saguna Brahma. You become a part of him. In Nirguna Brahma there is no part. All parts are removed and you discover you are identical to Brahman. So it's not Advaita. Some people have confused with this thing. Sayujya is Advaita they are talking. I don't want to take the names, they are popular. Well known, we are well known speakers on TVs. Anyway, probably they missed it, they misunderstood, or their guru did not tell them. So, or some people don't have gurus, they are self-study people, they study themselves and start speaking. That means they have no tradition. So, here, now, this is there in Upanishads, okay? Just now I told you all this Vaikuntha Prapti, these five kinds of moksha in Kailasa or Manidvipa or Vaikuntha, these are all five. These are all very high grade things, nothing wrong about it, they are very high grade. But there is another thing Upanishads talk about, and also Puranas, and all Devi Purana, Vishnu Purana, everything talks. Bhagavata Purana, another thing is directly discovering that you are Brahman. So this is another jnanam. As you know, you discover that you are. So the very knowing is experiencing. Knowing and experiencing, there is no gap. The very knowing is you are that. This shows that the experience is already there, you only have to discover. So this knowledge, some people, some non-Advaitins have missed. They have never found that this kind of knowledge which Advaitins talk about is ever present in Upanishads. They have never found it. That's because, why did they not find? That's because their guru, whomever they have accepted their guru, Ramanuja, Madhva, Nimbarka, Vallabha, Chaitanya, Muntada, etc. Whoever followed their gurus have told in the Upanishads, there is only such jnanam which should be followed by meditation, followed by certain other karma. The just knowing, by knowing alone, finding it, by knowing you become that, such a knowledge is not there in the Upanishads. Nobody told them. In their tradition, that doesn't exist. In their tradition, this Advaitins, the knowledge which Advaitins have understood. So in Shankaracharya's tradition, Shankaracharya studied from his guru and that guru. So there is another tradition of Upanishads where you find two types of jnanam. That which this Ramanuja etc. talk of, that knowledge is there, no doubt. But that is there in some places. But some places, this is another jnanam which Shankara or Advaitins talk about is, as you know, you discover you are Brahman. So, this is the two differences. We accept their kind of knowledge and Advaitin's kind of knowledge. Two kinds of knowledges are taught in the Upanishads. They accept only their kind of knowledge and the other kind of knowledge they never discussed. After reading Shankaracharya's Bhashya, they did not even refer to them. They did not say that, no, this is wrong or it is not there in the Upanishads. They didn't say anything. Simply, they felt as if it doesn't exist and continued with their own interpretations, that's all. So, this kind of knowledge you find clearly because Upanishad says, Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati, as you know, you are that. See, as you know, instantly, you are that. You discover that you are that. This is again and again, hundreds of times, you find stated in the Upanishads. Not only simple stated, you can see too. I will give you for Upanishads one or two examples, whether what I am telling is right or not. One place, as you know, one is Atra Brahma Samashnute. Upanishad says when you discover right now, you don't have, after knowing it, you will go to Loka, it doesn't say. There are two types of jnanam, as I told you, Nirguna Brahma jnanam. This jnanam which Advaitins talk about it wherever in the Upanishads, this jnanam arises. Two kinds of evidences in the Upanishads. One is, when you gain jnanam, the Upanishads openly says that right now you discover it. One. Second thing is, you can see in the dialogues, Nachiketa or Shvetaketu, wherever, even Maitreyi, wherever there is a dialogue between Guru and Shishya, when Guru teaches that you are Brahman, then explains it. After, at the end of the teaching, he discovers right now. And he says, yes, I have discovered, Guru says, Shishya says, and just go away. He doesn't say that after discovery you have to do this thing. He doesn't say that after the death of the body he reached the Loka, Brahma Loka. See, Upanishadic statements, you see, Nachiketa, when he discovered it, that's all. He understood that he is Brahman, and whoever learns this thing, he also discovers Brahman. That's all. Nachiketa, after he left the body and went to Brahmaloka, nowhere talked about it. Maitreyi, after discovering did these things, went away nowhere. What you call? And Shvetaketu in Tattvamasi Prakarana, or even Narada Sanat Kumara, Narada discovered that I am Brahman and became happy. That's all it says. But whereas in other places, where the Brahmaloka talked about it, after learning it, he practiced it. After practicing it, he will leave the body and he will go by this path and reach Brahmaloka. There he talks about the loka. There he talks about after the death of the body. There he reach how he will go, what path he will go, and he will teach the path also, how he will reach, after reaching what will he find. All that talks about. Now don't you see, these are the two separate things, two separate sadhanas, two separate things. One is attaining the Brahmaloka, another is discovering the Brahman right here. So, wherever there is a discovery of Brahman right now, this kind of knowledge is taught. You see in all the contexts of Upanishads. You have to survey all the Upanishads. The one problem and one mistake in our present way of studying is, each Upanishad they take up, study sentence by sentence, and study them and bhasha etc. and leave them. No, that is one way. Another thing is, study all the 12 Upanishads. All the 12 Upanishads, overall picture of all the 12 Upanishads, put together and study them. See them, all 12 Upanishads in one vision. See them, how differently they talk about. All 12 Upanishads, put together and study. As a whole. Then you see this kind of study. I am explaining only by keeping this in view, only from this angle of looking. You take up jnana. What are all the different dialogues? One is Kathopanishad. In Kathopanishad you can see Yama and Nachiketa. In Kena one dialogue, Mundaka one dialogue. In Chandogya many gurus and many dialogues. Many guru shishyas and many dialogues. Similarly in Brahadaranyaka many guru shishyas and dialogues. In Taittiriya two. Anandavalli is one guru shishya dialogue and Bhrguvalli is two. Taittiriya there are only two. But in Brahadaranyaka many. In all these dialogues, in all these samvadas, in all these teachings, in all these teachings you can see clearly there are two types of jnanam. One shishya, he teaches one jnanam where after knowing he practices and after the death of the body he reaches. Yet another jnanam he discovers right now, no going, no coming. He is already Brahma. So there you can see very clearly two types of jnanam. This see those non-advaitins, when they have written commentary on the Upanishads, this Shankara's direct jnanam and direct brahmatvam, they never touched it. All the Upanishadic mantras they have interpreted as after knowing do meditation, after the death of the body you go to another loka, Brahma loka, and will attain him. This is the interpretation they have done in all the Upanishads, as if the other jnanam doesn't exist at all. Whereas Advaitins, they accept both. To some places that kind of jnanam is there, going to Brahma loka. Another place, this is there. So two we have accepted. Therefore, Advaitins include Ramanuja Madhva's interpretation, their Vyakhyana, their Sadhana, their Moksha, Nimbarka, Vallabha, etc. Advaitins include their teaching also as a part, but they have got one more extra point. But for them, they exclude Advaitins in knowledge, Advaitins Moksha, as if it doesn't exist at all. Only theirs alone, all over, all Upanishads, that alone exists. So this is the difference. Just I want to point out, I am not refuting anybody, I am just pointing out the difference. See for yourself. So here, Badarayana, Athato Brahma Jignyasa, the very knowing is not talking, so the very knowing is Brahman, because Brahma Veda Brahma Iva Bhavati, Brahma Vidapnoti Param, one who knows, that's all. And the Taittiriya, where you see Brahma Vidapnoti Param in that context, you can see, first he says, by knowing Brahman you attain moksha. Then detailed discusses what is the nature of Brahman. Then panchakoshas he discusses. At the end he says, he gives up all the koshas and becomes Brahman. He understands that he is a Brahman and he becomes free in Ananda Swarupa. That's all. Ends. See, the Upadesha which starts with that one who knows Brahman attains moksha. It is the first sentence. Then the teaching, you see, you have to see the whole picture of one Upanishad, not sentence by sentence. people try to understand one sentence and we have understood whole vision of the whole Upanishad. Then towards the end, how the teaching runs. Vidyarthi student also listens to point by point, all panchakoshas. He gives up all five koshas, discovers that I am Brahman. That's all. With this discovery, he becomes happy, I am free from samsara. Upanishad ends. It doesn't talk of after the death of the body, you go there somewhere, and then the Brahmaloka Marga, the path to Vaikuntha or Kailasa, it doesn't discuss. That means here, with the knowledge alone, he understood. So, Bhrguvalli also talks like that. Katha also talks like that. So, this shows that clearly. So, there are two kinds of portions, two kinds of teachings in Upanishads. Two kinds of teaching, two kinds of knowledges. One knowledge is directly you discover. Another knowledge is after knowing all that I explained, you know, I don't repeat it. Only for some people, those who get mixed up, I just repeat so that you get clarity about it. Because these are the, when I speak, there are some of them you must have heard elsewhere with other gurus, but certain points I talk little differently, little extra point. Not differently, nothing, I won't compromise Bhashyakara or tradition, whatever is there, but certain points they don't emphasize. They just teach in their own way, in what you call, in their own one way. But I add certain other things. Therefore, those who listen to me, they find something new in my teaching. They say, we have never heard these things. You are bringing all these new things. Where do you get? It is already there. They only didn't touch. I am touching. That's all. I am comparing these two. They don't compare. They just take one thing and go away. So we compare these two. So just by knowing. Now here he says, how the very knowing Brahman attains it. Because anya jnanat anya praptir nahi upapadyate. Just by knowing, one thing, you can't attain something else. Isn't it? You can attain the thing what you know, what you understand. What you understand, the same you attain. By understanding one, you won't attain something else. Here, so from this, what do you understand? Here Upanishad says, or Sutra also says, the very knowing is attaining. The knowing is an experience. You just know, you are already that. So if knowing alone is attaining, that means what is to be attained is already in my experience. It is not outside you. It is not something away from you. You need to do some other effort in order to attain it. Therefore, Atma cha Brahma, that the Brahman, Brahma Jignasa, the desire to know Brahman, the Brahman which you are going to inquire and know, that Brahman is not away from the Atma. That's what he told. Atma bhuta brahma praptireva parama purushartha. Okay. If it is already my Atma, then what does that knowledge do? Next point now. Now this is today's talk. Until yesterday we discussed. Now today's talk is extra point. So far I have only repeated what we discussed yesterday. Now knowledge gives you. Okay, how does it give you? Knowledge gives you, knowledge helps you to discover that you are already Brahman. How? Now, what is that intercepting your anubhava? If you are already Brahman, what is intercepting your Brahma anubhava, which the knowledge can remove? Here, one more point, Swamiji, this is the last point, which is really basis for Adhyasa Bhashya. So knowledge cannot do anything. How the knowledge helps you to attain something. The very nature of knowledge we have to discover. We have to understand. How does knowledge help you to understand a thing or discover a thing or reach a thing? Find a thing. Finding means reaching. Attaining. Okay, let us say attaining. How does knowledge help a person to attain something? It can't help you to attain if you have already not that. Jnanam cannot give you what you already know, what is already not attained, what is already prapta, what is already in your anubhava, what is already your prapta, that alone it can point out. It can only awaken you to your anubhava. So knowledge can only do this much, knowledge can't do anything else. So knowledge doesn't do, knowledge does not bring an effect of karma. Okay. Knowledge does not bring an effect similar to that of karma. Karma does a different result. Karma produces four kinds of results that you know. I am not going to discuss. Four kinds of results. Karma can affect in these four ways. But jnanam, not in those, none of those four ways. Jnanam directly helps you to discover. How? What is that interception it removes? What can Jnanam remove? Some people told, there is a Mula Vidya, there is a covering on Brahman, it lifts the covering, it removes the covering, then you discover Brahman. No. Jnanam doesn't remove any covering, because there is no covering at all. Jnanam only corrects your vision. It only corrects adhyasa. This is where we say. The nature of jnanam can only correct your misunderstanding. This is the important point. So, nacha swarupa praptir nama. So that swarupa prapti by jnanam. By jnanam, the discovery of your own atma by jnanam can happen only by how? How does the jnanam operate? The very way of functioning. Anubhava rupa jnanam, the other kind of jnanam of non-advaitins, we already discussed and we set it aside. Now, the within the advaitins alone we are talking, how does the jnanam help you to discover your anubhava which is already there? Here also there are two views. Some people say jnanam can help you to discover partly. Other part you have to work hard to remove it. There again, what jnanam can remove? What jnanam can remove? They imagined what jnanam can remove is only ajnanam. Then what is the nature of ajnanam? How does it go away? This is the big topic. This is among the Advaitins alone. This has nothing to do with outsiders. Only among the Advaitins. The what is the nature of avidya? How will it go? Some people told that avidya is some kind of a veil. Veil means some kind of avarana. Some kind of a parada. Some kind of a screen on Brahman. And it won't go simultaneously. It will go gradually. It will go gradually. Okay. One thing. Second thing is, even after jnanam, a small part will, a trace of it, avidya lesha. Trace means a small portion. Lesha. So, the major portion of avidya will go away. 99% will go away. A small 1% will remain. Because of prarabdha. Only when the body dies, then the remaining remaining trace of avidya, avidya lesha, the small part will go away. After the death of the body, then you will attain the purna moksha. So, this is, so two points. One is the nature of avidya. And how will it go away? Second point is, how will it go away? So some people, some post-Shankarites have told that the nature of avidya is some kind of covering. And second point about avidya is, it will, even after jnanam, a small portion persists, a small bit of it persists, and that bit will go only by experiencing the prarabdha and dropping of the body. Then sharira patana. When the body drops off, when the body dies, then the remain. That means avidya can be removed in two stages. In one stage, the major portion of avidya will go away. And a small trace will continue even after Brahma Jnanam. And then at the end of the body, when the prarabdha is exhausted, even that remaining will. So that avidya removal in two stages. One is the nature of avidya is a covering. So the jnanam has to destroy the covering. Jnanam is born and it burns away. After the jnanam is born, it burns away the covering. And also retains a small portion of it. That will go away at later. So, two points. The nature of avidya is, it is a covering, it is a something positive. Bhava rupa mula avidya. Second is, it will go away gradually in two stages. So, in contrast with that, here Bhashyakara says, Swarupa praptir nama mithya jnana adhyastha vyavadhana hani vyatirekena margantarena nacha swarupa praptir nama mithya jnana adhyastha vyavadhana vyatirekena margantarena. This is the implication adhyasa comes in. Now he says that jnanam can help you to discover your atma swarupam as Brahman. That you are already existing Brahman, you come to discover it. So the jnanam only, jnanam helps you to discover. Means what? Jnanam is discovery. This is the way of telling. Jnanam is discovery. The very discovery is attainment. Discovery and attaining are not two steps. It is not that first you understand and later you attain. They say like that. They first you understand and later you attain. There is no gap. They are not two steps. Very understanding is you are already Brahman. You understand that you are already Brahman. Therefore, the very knowing is... here one more thing. How do you remove the ignorance? Knowing Brahman and removing the ignorance are not two steps. This is also one more thing. Knowing Brahman and removing ignorance. They say, first you jnanam comes, then avidya goes away. They said there is a split second gap. Two steps they put it. Jnanam rises and removes avidya. And that also it removes avidya in two stages. One, the major portion, 99% will go away, and last 1% will go at a later stage. So this is too much. So because when you bring the light, do you think after light comes, then after 2 or 3 seconds, 10 seconds, then darkness will go away? When you switch on the light, do you feel that the light comes, then the darkness will go away gradually? And also a part of darkness will remain, and much later that light will be fighting with darkness for a long time. At the end of it, can you say like that? This is what they seem to say. So that doesn't suit. That's not a right thing. Knowledge and removal of ignorance are not two. See, knowing Brahma and removal ignorance are not two. Very knowing is removing ignorance. Removing ignorance is knowing. There are two ways of telling the one thing. The one thing you talk about in two ways, isn't it? He is not at home. That means he is outside. He is outside means he is not at home. You know how Indians talk of it? Indians want to verify. Because people talk from different angles with different implications. You go to meet somebody. This is what I generally see. I am a villager. I was born and brought up in a village. I see that when people come, they say they want to talk to him. They say, is the owner at home? Can I meet him? Is he available? Now the wife or somebody, son or wife of him, they say, no, he is out of station. They say, oh, you mean he is not at home? They ask another question. When he is out of station, do you need this second question? They say he has gone out to another town. They say he has gone out to another town. They ask again, do you mean he is not at home? Then I was surprised, what does it mean? When you say that he has gone out, that means he is not at home. Do you have to say that? When he is out of station, means he is not at home. He is not at home means he has gone outside. Both mean the same thing. But Indian way of telling is, because they want to know implicate, because Indians also talk very cleverly. He is out of station means he is going. Probably they mean that he is preparing and he won't be able to talk to you. But they don't want to say he is going out of station. They say he is already gone. Therefore, they want to verify. Has he really gone or is he sitting at home and is preparing to go? If he is at home, I will talk to him. Therefore, they say, oh, you mean he is not at home? They want to confirm again. Do you mean he is not at home? So he has gone out? Yeah, he has gone out. Oh, do you mean he is not at home? Do you mean he is not eating? Do you mean he is not drinking water? Do you mean he is... Why do you ask this thing? Because the villagers talk like that. So that's a different, leave it. But here, simple fact is, when the knowledge takes place, there is no avidya. But they put it, some of the post-Shankarites, they put them, after the knowledge, avidya goes away. Knowledge coming and avidya going are the two steps. Here Shankara says, knowledge coming and avidya going are not two. As the knowledge comes, it arises. The very rising of knowledge is while eliminating the ignorance. Eliminating the ignorance, rising of knowledge are not two. They are just one. Okay. Second point is, what is that nature of knowledge that you remove it? There is no veil. There is no avarana. There is no positive mulavidya bhavarupa to remove it. Knowledge is, avidya is only a misunderstanding. Because when you are already Brahman, how can there be something to cover you? Is your consciousness ever covered? Tell me. See, whenever you know something, are you not conscious? You are always conscious. The consciousness may be little muddled with other things. because your consciousness is mixed with mind and sense organ, etc. But consciousness itself is never covered. Do you see it is ever covered? Consciousness is always there. Always there. Because you are always conscious. Consciousness is always there. In the consciousness alone, you sit and walk and drink and eat and everything, whatever you do, speak and listen, anything you do in the consciousness alone. So there is no time you are not conscious. Covering the consciousness means what? You become totally ignorant. You become unconscious. Covering of consciousness, they say avarana. Avarana means you become unconscious. Do you ever become unconscious? There is no such thing called unconsciousness. Do you ever experience unconsciousness? There is always consciousness. Even in deep sleep, there is consciousness. Therefore, there is no unconsciousness at all. There is a continuous consciousness only. Therefore, ajnanam is not a veil or not a covering upon Brahman. It is only a misunderstanding. It is only adhyasa. That in your consciousness, you see that there is something limited entity within you. You are conscious, but conscious as a knower. See, knower is consciousness, Sakshi is also conscious. But here, knowerhood, knowership is the consciousness. So you think that in the consciousness, there is misunderstanding. Okay. So you are not seeing the pure non-dual consciousness, you always see something knowing. Because the consciousness is always related to some object. Your consciousness is not pure consciousness, you are conscious of something. So your consciousness is always related to some object. So this relative consciousness is what we have. We don't have absolute independent consciousness. It is a relative consciousness. So this is what we mean adhyasa. Therefore, mithyajnana, so the jnanam corrects. Correct, jnanam removes ignorance. In fact, this remove is not a right way of telling. Removing is a literal translation of the Sanskrit word nivritti. Because that nivritti is a Sanskrit word, we tend to translate it literally as a removal. There is no removal because it doesn't exist. We only shift to the standpoint from the avidya drishti to the swarupa drishti, then you understand that avidya is not there. See, because of your wrong, what is found with a wrong standpoint will naturally be not there when you take a right standpoint. See, when you look at it from right angle, what you found from a wrong angle won't be there. So therefore, that wrong angle of looking is avidya. There is no substantial avidya there. A positive avidya, wrong angle of looking is avidya. That's what we call adhyasa. What is adhyasa? Adhyasa is misunderstanding. Misunderstanding means what? You look at it from a wrong angle. The looking it from wrong angle is adhyasa. That is mithyajnanam. This is where Shankara got the clue in the sutras, in the Upanishadic Vakyas. In the Upanishadic statements, in the Brahma Sutras, in the Badarayana's Brahma Sutra, he got this implication that it is a misunderstanding. That it is a wrong angle of looking, wrong standpoint of looking at yourself. So this wrong standpoint needs to be corrected. Therefore, in Athato Brahma Jignasa, when you are inquiring into Brahman and trying to understand Atman, what does that understanding jnanam do? It corrects the misunderstanding. Then what is that misunderstanding? Taking a wrong standpoint is the misunderstanding. That is called adhyasa. That is called adhyasa, that is called superimposition. So taking a wrong standpoint is corrected by jnanam. What does the jnanam do? How does the jnanam arise? By vichara. By inquiry, knowledge arises. That knowledge corrects your wrong standpoint you took. And when you correct the wrong standpoint, that's all, you are already Brahman. Therefore, this wrong standpoint, taking a wrong standpoint, looking from a wrong standpoint, or in other words, misunderstanding, is called adhyasa, mithyajnanam, adhyaropa, all these thing words. So this adhyaropa, ajnanam, is what sutrakara and Upanishadic mantrushis are keeping in view and talking. In the next sentence, let us say, tadevam arthat suchitam. Arthat suchana is implication. See, in Sanskrit, arthat suchana. Suchana is suggestion. अर्थात सूचयति मीन्स इम्प्लाइज अर्थात सूचयति संस्कृत ईडियम अर्थ अर्थ मीन्स इम्प्लिकेशन ओनली अर्थात सूचितम मीन्स दिस अध्यासा इज द अविद्या and that is the real interpretation wrong standpoint that you are taking that you are in taking means you are in a wrong standpoint from that standpoint you are looking at yourself you are missing brahman because you are looking from wrong standpoint you are missing yourself as brahman your being brahman is missed because you are looking yourself from wrong standpoint okay this wrong standpoint is adhyasa and this adhyasa needs to be corrected so that adhyasa is the only problem which can be corrected by jnanam this implication is given by upanishadic mantras as well as the brahma sutra shankara got this implication which many missed it of course shankara had a right tradition that the his guru and paramaguru gaudapada govindapada are even earlier gurus the gurus are the right tradition he got it luckily two ways sometimes you get a right guru and you get a right sampradaya sometimes your bhagwan gives you god gives you some kind of a good thinking right thinking that you listen you read various books you listen to various gurus out of them some kind of a guru alone appeals to you some kind of teaching alone appeals to you why not the other because your mind god has given you certain state of mind certain thinking certain maturity certain way of thinking you already have because of that you get attracted to certain teaching certain guru alone appeals to you that means you have a certain state of mind how did you get it due to purva janma punya due to the blessing of god alone otherwise we have no way see all teachings advaita dvaita vishishta dvaita many teachings are already available in the society many gurus are there many books are there why do I get it one reason is supposing I come to read some book you may read we also come to read many books like that many gurus we listen we listen to many gurus we read many books but out of them one of them alone appeals to you it depends upon your state of mind your maturity level of mind according to your maturity level you start liking you start feeling that this is suited to my anubhava this shows that this is close to my anubhava this is according to my anubhava therefore you go in this line so but that state of mind how do you get it due to your purva janma punya our duty or ishwara anugraha therefore so either we may say it is shankara's intelligence or due to punya or anugraha we don't know whatever it is difficult to explain but anyway I explained a little bit whatever I could do but shankara got the right tradition so there his gurus his tradition teaches that brahma jignas upanishad is telling jnanad mokshaha upanishad and brahma sutrakara is telling only brahma jignas I is not telling anything just knowing brahman Do vichara to know Brahman, that's all. The knowing alone gives you moksha. So from these two, Shankara got the implication that misunderstanding is the only avidya that needs to be removed. Then what is the nature of misunderstanding and how is it, where in your anubhava, where is it? Where is it in your anubhava and what is the nature of adhyasa? That has to be discovered. That has to be discussed. Getting this clue, Shankara explains adhyasa bhashya. Appa, after this 4 or 5 days, how many days I don't know, we have come to the adhyasa. In between we went away so many places. So tadevam arthat suchitam, what is implied in this brahma sutras as well as upanishadic mantras, samsaratva adhyasa krutatvam, this samsara is due to misunderstanding alone. Bhagavan bhashyakarah shankaracharyah sakala shastro upodghatatvena upanibadnati. He understood this implication as an adhyasa and that adhyasa he presents as a preface to the brahma sutra bhashya. He puts it as a preface upodghata to the entire sutra bhashya. See, upodghatatvena upanibadhnati, he presents here as an upodghata, or upodghata means preface to the entire brahma sutra bhashya. Now this is how we understand, where did Shankara get this adhyasa bhashyam? That is a very sharp brain and also guru anugraha and his sampradaya anugraha, he found it is there. Now he has to explain what is the nature of that adhyasa or avidya, and where do you find it in your anubhava. He has to point out, he has to help you to see how it is there, how it is and where is it in your anubhava. two things he has to point out, and he will point out. Therefore, yushma dasmat pratyaya gocharayoh. This much is the Swamiji's introduction. Now is he connecting to first sentence of Adhyasa Bhashya. Yushma dasmat pratyaya gocharayoh. This is how Adhyasa Bhashya begins. So, yushma dasmat pratyaya gocharayoh ityadina. It begins with this, ends where asyanarthaheto prahanaya atmaikatva vidya pratipattaye sarve vedantaha arabhyante. This is the last sentence. From this sentence to this sentence, Adhyasa constitutes. Why do you have to say this? See, in those days, manuscripts were available. There is no paragraph division. There is no heading. Nobody said that this is Upodghata. Now Upodghata ends. So, in those days, there were no headings and there was no paragraph division because it was written in manuscripts. Or orally, they were memorizing it. They would not know. That's why in Bhagavad Gita, I say, Atha Prathamodhyayaha. Why do we have to say? Because all this is a continuity in manuscript. No page changing or paragraph changing is not there. So we would not know. We have to say that new adhyaya I begin. Therefore we have to say athato prathamodhyayaha dvitiyodhyayaha. Then iti prathamodhyayaha. Now the first chapter ends. Atha dvitiyodhyaya. We have to say. That means here the topic ended and a new chapter we are beginning. Because in manuscript and in oral tradition we have to say. Nowadays we just don't say directly change the paragraph, change the line and continue. You understand the topic has changed. So similarly, so here is explaining this Upodghata constitute from this word to this word, this much is Adhyasa Bhashya. Now, Asya cha bhashya granthasya vimarshartam vibhagasho artham yathamati pradarsha ishamaha. First I divide this Adhyasa Bhashya. Even Adhyasa Bhashya generally in manuscript you find whole thing as a one paragraph. He says, I divide into paragraphs because the ideas change. I divide into paragraph and then take up the each para and discuss. This is what our Swamiji told. Now I say, how many parts, how many paragraphs he divided? Swamiji divided them into 9 paragraphs. Okay. 9 parts he divided. You can see them, 9 chapters. 9 parts he divided and point by point he discusses them elaborately. So first part is Pratignya. He has given a name to that each portion. One is the Pratignya Bhashyam. Adhyasa Pratignya. Pratignya means he is going to say, he says that now Adhyasa I am going to discuss. Then what is that Adhyasa Pratignya Bhashyam is first portion around 10-11 pages. This first Pratignya Bhashyam we are going to discuss. Okay. It is just reading out 2 lines alone. Let me, time is up. Okay. I'll read out 2 or 3 sentences so that tomorrow we can start directly Adhyasa. Number 2. Those who are referring the book, I can say the number 2 chapter. Swamiji's number 2 is beginning, Pratignya Bhashya Vibhagaha. Tatra, and the first paragraph, Vicharavataranika, this para ends. We are beginning the next point, Pratignya Bhashya Vibhagaha. You can see it is in bold. Tatra tathapi ityarabhya naisargikoyam lokavyavaharaha. Ityetadantam bhashyam tavad atmanatmano ritaretaradhyasaha swabhavata heva loke pravartamano drishyate iti pratijanite. Yushmadasmat pratyaya gocharayoha ityarabhya. Mityeti bhavitam yuktam ityantam tu uptadhyaso yuktya nirupyamano nopapadyate iti shanka samutthanartham iti vivekaha. There is nothing. It is just 1 or 2 sentences. Idea I will tell you. The first whole adhyasa bhashya Swamiji told he is dividing into few parts. That is 9 parts. Out of them the first part is pratignya bhashya. Within adhyasa bhashya first part is pratignya bhashya. In pratignya bhashya there are 2 sentences. So what do they mean? He is giving a general idea so that you will understand when we discuss in details. Before we go into details, first we have an outlines. So in these 2 sentences, second sentence talks of where is Adhyasa and what is Adhyasa. First sentence says an objection. This Adhyasa is not possible. First he says Adhyasa is not at all possible. And second sentence says how it is there in everybody's experience. What is that Adhyasa and how it is found in everybody's experience. These 2 points constitute this first section, first division, let us say, first portion of Adhyasa Bhashya called Pratignya Bhashyam. Now Adhyase Shanka. We'll take the first sentence and discuss it. So we'll start with tomorrow. Adhyasa Bhashya's first sentence, and you see how beautiful his Swamiji's explanation is. I think you will never find such an explanation. Adhyasa, he shows it right now in your anubhava. You don't have to blindly accept anything. Point by point, he shows you right in your anubhava. more you discover, more you are a different person. Okay, so we'll discuss tomorrow. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om Tat Sat. So just 11 o'clock we will have next class in Kannada. You may have to wait few minutes because of this current and this thing fluctuations and all. So maybe 2-3 minutes, 5 minutes may be late. Otherwise, generally I come to by 11. Okay, Om. Oh.